Welcome to Mirror Domains, movie news, your place for entertainment headlines. This is indeed a live news show, where we talk about all the trending movie news headlines of the day for Friday, January 27th, 2023. On today's show, we're going to be talking about Percy Jackson. Some casting news about that TV show. Stephen Dorff makes a fool of himself talking about comic book and superhero movies. We got some talking about Thunderbolts there. That's some comic book news. But we start off today by talking about Avatar 2. Avatar, The Way of Water, becomes the fifth highest grossing movie of all time. There you go. I realize now that I didn't properly set up my Chrome. You know why? Because I got two open, that's why. James, I got two open. There we go. Sorry about that. Avatar 2, Way of Water, passes Infinity War as fifth biggest movie ever with $2.05 billion. So let's take a look at the old top five. Avatar is number one with $2.9 billion. Avengers Endgame is 2.7, almost 2.8. It'll get 2.8 billion. Titanic is number three with 2.19 billion. Star Wars Force Awakens, just over 2 billion. And Avatar The Way of Water passes Infinity War with 2 billion and 54 million. So, 2 billion, 54 million. Yeah. Guys, I think it's going to catch Force Awakens. So it's going to be number four. That's what's going to happen. Avatar The Way of Water. I said that it was going to be around $2.3 billion. I'm actually leaning towards this. Probably going to start to slow down around the 220-ish mark. But it's still going to rake in another... I still think it's going to rake in another $300 million at least. So yeah, maybe closer to 2.4 billion. So it's easily going to be in the fourth spot. And that's for the worldwide numbers. Make sure that you are cognizant of that when you're talking about this, that you're talking about the worldwide numbers, not the domestic numbers, because it's not going to be number, it's not going to be, well, actually, will it be in the top five for domestic numbers? I think it will be, maybe. Because number one is Force Awakens for domestically, because it made 936 in the domestic box office. Wow. Avengers Endgame was number two in the domestic box office. That's North America, guys. 858 million. Spider-Man No Way Home, 814 million. Avatar, so even the first Avatar didn't even get in. They just barely got into the top five, right? 785 domestically. And Top Gun Maverick from this last year, 2022, is number five, 718. But when we look at the worldwide numbers, of course, that's adjusted for like international numbers as well. You know, Top Gun Maverick is still up there. 1.4 billion. It's going to be like 1.5 billion, I think. It's good. And as you can see, the numbers here, they do show the domestic here. So, looking at Avatar The Way of Water's domestic, it's 603 million. 603 million. Top Gun Maverick, 718. I don't see Avatar The Way of Water hitting, making that for the domestic numbers. I don't. Because it's really slowed down here in North America. Avatar The Way of Water's numbers is one of those movies where it's all international numbers, guys. 1.4 billion internationally. It's people like the blue people for some reason. Are you one of those people? Don't be ashamed if you are, to say that you are. We're movie fans here, and I'm on this kind of a page with Avatar, and I gotta say this lightly too. I don't hate the Avatar movies. I don't. I had fun with the first one. I went out and saw it in the theater. I was kind of like, okay. I think I saw it on a streaming service. No, I saw it on a normal TV once after that. So I've only seen it twice. Avatar 2, I've only seen once. I'm the kind of person where I don't want to go out and see a movie multiple times in the theater because I do a movie news show. I watch movies. I watch things that have come out. I would rather go see things that I haven't seen in the theater first before I go back and watch something that I've seen already, right? I probably will watch Avatar 2 again. I'm not one of those people that goes out multiple times, but apparently a lot of people are. A lot of people are for Avatar The Way of Water. Just the numbers show it. They think that it's a masterpiece. They think it's a stellar work of art. The story is just resonating with people. It's something that I don't quite understand, because if I were to put together my top five movies of all time, Avatar would not be in that conversation. And I don't want to have that come off negatively too, right? With people saying, well, then you're a hater. No, no, I'm just not enthralled with it. It doesn't speak to me. Actually, none of these top five would be in there for me. And actually, none of these movies would be in my top five, because it's personal preference, right? And let's take it like this. Box office success does not necessarily dictate the quality of the movie, right? But you got to acknowledge the achievement. That's the way that I look at it. I acknowledge the achievement, and lots of people are having fun with it. So I say, okay, fine. It is what it is. Probably doesn't do a whole lot of good for James Cameron's ego, because you hear stories about him being I'm not going to get into that. It's hard not to when you got three of the highest grossing movies of all time in your resume. And I guess I'm somebody who thinks that the Avatar movies are not even close to being James Cameron's best films. For me, it's still probably Terminator 2, Aliens. I really like Abyss. Those would be my top three right now, I would say. And then Terminator 1. And I even liked that fish movie. You know, what was it? Piranha 2, The Spawning. Yeah. Okay. Guys, talking about Avatar, let's just take a quick little headline here that caught my eye. Sigourney Weaver directed an Avatar 2 scene. James Cameron reveals why. Yeah, because Sigourney Weaver plays the younger daughter. Now, I think, for me, she was my favorite character in the story. I didn't really care about the brothers or anything like that. I know a lot of people did. Come on. So she's playing like a 14-year-old girl or something, and basically Cameron said to her while they were rehearsing or something, go and work with this other girl. Kiri visits her mother and has a short conversation with her, and Weaver is actually running double duty. She is both acting and directing the scene. Okay. With her mother. That's that scene where they're actually in the laboratory, right? Right? Is that one? I think about that the day that she was in the spirit world. Yeah, in the spirit world, right? And she was meeting her mother. And Sigourney had to quickly switch back and forth between them. Yeah. Because she's playing the younger version, the sort of called, the blue person of her. And she's playing the scientist version in like a dream sequence in the movie. And I guess she kind of like helped the young actress along with that scene because she wanted to know how to emulate her and stuff like that, right? So that's that scene. I just thought that was interesting. Sigourney Weaver is huge talent, right? Great career, great resume. And it's cool that Cameron goes back and works with these actors and includes them in stuff. Cameron's really good for that. Christopher Nolan's really good for that. And that's cool. Yeah, she's definitely my favorite character in this because she speaks to the planet, right? That's the way I feel about it. Just a cool little headline, just a little in the know. She directed that scene. I felt like that was pretty cool. What do you guys think about that? Avatar becoming the fifth highest movie of all time, and some Sigourney Weaver directing that scene. That's kind of cool. Okay, We Have a Ghost is coming on Netflix. We Have a Ghost, Chris Landon's film. It's a 2023 must-watch. Watch! Not wash, James. Happy Death Day director, Christopher Landon. Okay, so it's from the same guy who did Happy Death Day. And we got David Harbour here as the ghost. That's going to be with Anthony Mackie. He gets a family, moves into this place where this guy, I guess, did himself in or something. Or I think there was some foul play. I figured, well, you know what? We might as well watch this trailer together because I was going to watch it yesterday. I forgot that in our little roundup there in the afternoon that we were going to watch this trailer. I don't care if this gets copyright claimed. We will watch this trailer right now. We have a ghost, David Harbour, Anthony Mackie. Let me just pull it up right here, and we will get underway for We Have a Ghost. Okay. Whoops. Easy there, James. Easy. Okay. Take off the banner. Take off that. We're ready. We Have a Ghost on Netflix. Let's check it out.
We're all here trying to get a fresh start.
Nothing like bad happened here, right?
So is it a scary ghost?
You moved into the house of death? Everyone house says of it's death. Haunted.
Haunted. Oh. David Harbour. Yeah, that's right. They monetize him, right?
Don't go.
They start putting him on like TikTok and stuff.
Ghost. Okay. No, I'm serious. Kevin caught him on camera. Oh, we gotta show mom.
No.
The entire world.
But this movie has potential to be
with Ernest.
3 million
having
views
a heart,
in 6
right?
minutes.
That's money.
Our whole state kind of bad, thanks to you guys.
Jesus Christ.
Not funny.
Right?
I'm Kevin. Whoa, that's so trippy. Can you talk? What happened to you?
What happened to you? Oh, you're right. You and then they try to find out, like, he was murdered, right? This
if
February.
Find out what happened? It's out there.
Uh-oh. So we got music here. Break on through to the other side. No, that's not the Doors version. Is that a cover?
Apprehend the ghost.
Light him up!
Apprehend the ghost.
Yeah. Being an outlaw suits you.
So it's got that fun levity to it, right? Quirkiness. I think having David Harbour do this is going to work wonders for him, right?
So, Frank, is he here now?
Ready to have some
Jennifer
fun.
Coolidge, right? Yeah, she's cool. February 24th, guys, on Netflix. What did you think about that trailer? Is it something that you want to check out? Is it something that we should do a full live watch-along for? Well, hey, that's what we do here on this channel, right? We're everything movies. I liked it. Oops, sorry. Did you guys actually hear the end of that trailer? I might have actually muted the song, and then you might not have been able to hear it. Oh, well. It is what it is. It happens. It's not as if anybody's going to be searching the web for a trailer reaction to this. Just to let you know that I saw it. Scroll down here and see what people are saying in the comments. I love David Harbour. This looks hilarious and fun, or fun and hilarious. Okay, this is not what I expected, and I'm happy I was wrong. This looks like mad fun. David Harbour is on fire with these movies. First, it was Violent Night, and this is very cool, or very good. I will absolutely watch. Yeah. So people are, you got the David Harbour fans, Anthony Mackie. No Anthony Mackie fans? Jennifer Coolidge was kind of fun in this too, right? A lot of people really liked Violent Night, and Argos Viking says this looks entertaining. This is on the watch list for sure. Yeah, it's a Doors song breakthrough. Yeah, but no, I thought it didn't sound like him though. It sounded like that was a cover song of it. Maybe I just wasn't hearing it properly because I was trying to cover up and mute it for you guys, so I don't get a copyright claim. All right, February 24th, We Have a Ghost. Very fascinating. Let's take a break here and tell you what you can find here on the channel. We do a movie news show It's not daily anymore, so I'm going to have to update this bar. It's Mondays to Fridays. Monday and Friday. Sorry, guys. And it'll be at 11 a.m., so that's all I have to fix. There are all my other social media handles, guys. You can follow me there and check out the, you know, some behind-the-scenes stuff. And let me tell you what you can find here on the channel. Besides movie news stuff, we do full series and movie watch-alongs. So we do series watch-alongs for The Last of Us we're watching right now every Monday, 1 p.m. And we're having, well, lots of fun watching that. Later on today, hopefully I can get this posted up. I did a music video reaction to Taylor Swift's new music video. I don't know if that one's going to go live, but later on today, 1 p.m. today, guys, we are going to be watching You People on Netflix. Yeah, we just watched a Netflix trailer. Jonah Hill, Eddie Murphy. It's kind of like a fish out of water kind of thing, right? 1 p.m. today, we'll be watching that on Netflix. And if you like movie reactions, we do Jung E, Duel. We watch retro movies on Thursdays, Mortal Kombat, and we do this by polls. So you can go up to the community tab and look for next week's poll. And I think right now, Arnold Schwarzenegger's Total Recall is in the lead, just over the original Candyman movie. But go over and take a look at the polls, guys. On the Saturdays, we do a horror movie. Last week, we did The Innocents. This week, we'll be watching The Last Night in Soho. Last Night in Soho. Anya Taylor-Joy, Matt Smith, and Thomas and Mackenzie. Edgar Wright film. 1 p.m. on Saturday, guys, tomorrow. And in the morning, we'll be doing a horror weekly roundup show where we talk about all the trending horror movie news headlines, including Infinity Pool, that I'll be going out and seeing later on today at 4 p.m., actually. I'll be seeing Infinity Pool, so we'll be looking and talking about that mostly for the next day or so. Yeah, look forward to that. Everything movies here, trailer reactions. Movie reviews, movie news, full movie watch-alongs. Hey, if you like movies, you're going to like it here on Mirror Domain. So hit that subscribe button, thumbs up, you know all that jazz. I don't like to say that, but it is what it is. All right, let's get back into the movie news for today. Yeah, I was going to have it like a two-hour movie news show, but when I started to look at the headlines today, there really just wasn't that much. So I was kind of like, well, I could try to stretch it. I could talk about stories and opinion pieces. But You People came out on Netflix today, so we might as well watch that movie. Okay, back into the news. Blake Lively. I like her as an actress. Yeah, The Shallows was pretty good. Married to Ryan Reynolds. Blake Lively and Justin Baldoni to star in It Ends With Us. Baldoni's also directing Sony and Wayfarer Studios adaptation of Colleen Hoover novel. Now, so this guy's directing this as well. So what's this about? It Ends With Us. This goes on to talk about a bunch of the business side of things. But the story follows a girl named Lily who has just moved and is ready to start her life after college. Lily then meets a guy named Ryle. And she falls for him. As she is developing feelings for Ryle, at last, her first love reappears and challenges the relationship between Lily and Ryle. So is there going to be kind of like a duel for her love, for her hand? How romantic, right? Hey, you know what? It is, I don't mind rom-coms every now and then. That's a very basic premise. I got no problem with that. Hey, what's this, Taylor Swift? What? Lively is coming off her directorial debut with the Taylor Swift 2001 music video for I Bet You Think About Me. Oh, okay. She directed that one? Taylor's directing her own stuff now. And hopefully that video goes through. Later on today, I'll try to get that reaction video up for you guys from that Taylor Swift song. Lively is represented. Okay. Comments. We got some comments. Excellent. I want to see it now. Blake is amazing, and I don't see her as Lily. I totally see her as Verity from Coho's other book. Okay, so we got some fans of the source material here weighing in with their thoughts, saying that maybe she's not the best casting and suited for this role. Hey, it's a book. It's a page. It's a description. It is something that can be altered. Blake Lively's a good actress, and it's good. Well, she took a lot of time off to start a family there with Ryan Reynolds, right? Because after The Shallows, She really hasn't appeared in too much. But this article goes on to say that apparently, aside from this project, she's also going to be in a sequel to A Simple Plan, or Simple Favor. Yeah. Lively is set to reprise her role in an upcoming Simple Favor sequel with Andrew Kendrick and Paul Feig returning to direct. Yeah, I heard rumblings of that. And Anna Kendrick was in a movie this month, too, that didn't get a wide release. Was it like where a boyfriend kind of like stalks her on a girl's getaway weekend, right? Yeah, that's not out. And I want to check that out because I do like Anna Kendrick and I did like A Simple Favor. Cool. I'll be checking this out. We'll keep our eye on that. Are you a Blake Lively fan? Let me know in the comments below and we will talk about it. I am a huge Emilia Clarke fan. Because I was a Game of Thrones fan. And I was rooting for Daenerys to, not kill everybody, which she did. But, you know, every now and then, everybody goes a little bit crazy, right? It's okay. Anyway, Emilia Clarke's new film, The Pod Generation, satirizes the probable future of pregnancy at a Sundance premiere. This movie is also going to have Chiwetel Ejiofor in it. I guess they play a couple where, in the future, babies are not born the traditional way. They get incubated in like these eggs. It's like a bleak future kind of thing. Very interesting. Directed by Sophie Barthez. A young couple, Rachel. Not exactly that young. I would say like late 30s. I'd say 40s almost. Maybe late 30s. Chiwetel Ejiofor is in his 40s though. Young couple is not what I would say here. Rachel and Alvy, who live in futuristic New York that is entirely run, or rather overrun, by technology. Homes are wholly run by AI similar to Alexa, and schedule everything in a person's day from sunrise to sunset. Rachel unironically works at a tech company in the city and schedules nature pod visits to reconnect her mind with nature, albeit via synthetic images and sounds fed to her. Alvy, meanwhile, also ironically, is a botany teacher who works with actual living plant life. Wow. So it's really far out there, right? Sounds intriguing. I like this kind of abstract story. One day, Rachel is informed that she's been picked for a long wait list for an egg baby, which involves growing an actual child inside an egg-shaped pod rather than naturally. Yeah, so that's what we see here, right? Very, why not? Do people not like to get jiggy with it anymore? That's one of the pleasures of having human flesh, is that you get to indulge in those pleasures, right? No? Yes? Yes? No? The Pod Generation found success with its Sundance premiere. So people liked it at Sundance, taking home the feature film prize, the Sundance Institute Science in Film Initiative. Okay. Whatever the heck that is. After telling Alvy they received their new pod egg, and each go on their daily lives until the new child is born from its plastic shell. That's really weird, man. I don't know if I could handle that. Rachel enjoys work and going out as she pleases, but Alvy starts to grow attached to their pod, wanting to spend most of his time with it, and essentially takes on a maternal pseudo-pregnant role. Okay, so it's a bit of role reversal, huh? Chiwetel Ejiofor will be able to handle that for sure. The purpose of the pod is no longer about the convenience and instead recreates the biological connection to the creation of a human life. Okay, so yeah, they go on to explore some of those ideas. The pod generation is about isolating us from the most human parts of ourselves. Well, like our instincts. You know, I thought about that the other day too. Like, what are our instincts as humans? You know, what do we naturally do as humans? Is it just to recreate, to go and procreate and propagate the species? Because, you know, beavers, they build dams, right? Dogs like to dig in the dirt and burrow holes and stuff like that. hunt in packs. They instinctually know how to do all of this stuff, right? What do we instinctually know how to do as humans? What do we do? Is it just to recreate? I mean, what do we do? I don't know. I just build a shelter over us, like Maslow's hierarchy of needs, or I don't know what our instincts are. I don't know. Other than, hey, you know what? I like. it's just bizarre. Yeah, I'm getting off on a tangent here. Emilia Clarke is going to be also in the MCU series, right? She's going to be in not Secret Wars, Secret Invasion TV series with Samuel L. Jackson, right? About the green people that come in and replace people. Anyway, talking about the MCU, Marvel's Thunderbolts enlists the Bear star, Ayo Idibiri. Now, I don't watch The Bear because I don't watch a lot of TV, actually, to tell you the truth. I watch movies and I watch sports. Actually, I haven't even been watching sports. Shame on me. I watched football until my Bills lost last week. I guess I'll be watching hockey now until it's time to get ready for the playoffs and watch the Maple Leafs bow out gracefully in the first round again. Anyway, wow, my mind is just going all over the place today. Marvel's Thunderbolts enlists The Bear. Now, I never watched The Bear, but I guess, yeah, she looked familiar to me. But when I looked her up in her resume, I didn't quite recognize her. I guess she plays a line cook or something in that series. But she's going to be in that Thunderbolts movie, which is kind of like their version of the Suicide Squad, right? With Florence Pugh and Sebastian Stan. Okay, just a quick little headline in there. Yeah. Okay. Every now and then, people make fools of themselves. Sort of like me when I fumble the ball, like, over my words and stuff. But, yeah, sometimes you make a fool of yourself in the headlines as well. And Stephen Dorff just happens to be one of those people this week. Well, actually, we've heard this before from him too, right? Original Blade star Stephen Dorff is sick of Marvel's worthless garbage. Mocks MCU's Blade. We already did it and made it the best. Is this why perhaps you're not getting a whole lot of work, Stephen? has your resume, like, what have you been in recently that I would have seen? Actually, I didn't hate him as an actor. I didn't. Didn't hate him in the first Blade movie. But yeah, he's come out and said several stuff like this, ragging on comic book movies, saying that he would never be in one and it's below him and it's like lower tier acting. And people have come out and said that, you know, tried to rebut that and stuff. I'm not going to get into that, but let's take a look at his quote here about this new Blade. Because they are rebooting Blade, right, with Mahershala Ali, that's going to be like 50 years old next month or something. I don't understand what the MCU is doing. I really don't. But so I'm a little bit on the page with him about that, kind of like what's going on. But I wouldn't call it worthless garbage. And let's see what he says. All this other garbage is just embarrassing. You know what I mean? Dorff continued. Yeah. So, yeah, he was embarrassed for Scarlett Johansson to be in stuff like Black Widow. That was his earlier comments, right? All this other garbage is just embarrassing. You know what I mean? I mean, God bless them. They're making a bunch of money, but their movies suck. And nobody's going to remember them. Nobody's remembering Black Adam at the end of the day. I didn't even see that movie. It looked so bad. I had fun with Black Adam. Black Adam had potential, but it needed work on the script. According to Dorff, the future of cinema rests upon it in upcoming new talents like director Edie Alcazar, who helmed a Sundance entry, Divinity, which Dorff stars in. Okay, so that's why he's making all these comments, because he's trying to create buzz. Maybe that's his angle. He wants to ruffle the feathers of a few of us movie fans, our diehard movie news fans. get us talking about it, which he has. I guess it sort of worked, right? We're talking about it. Marvel is currently developing a new take on this Blade. Yeah. So there you go, Stephen. You got your little piece in, and we looked up that movie Divinity, or we heard about it, that debuted at Sundance. That's why he said all this stuff. We don't go over to the Daily Beast or the Daily Wire or anything like that. We don't. Not on this channel. But what do you think about his comments? And do you think that they could... Well, is this warranted? We already did it and made it the best. We don't know what kind of direction the new Blade is going to go in, right? I really enjoyed the Wesley Snipes version. I think I do have a VHS copy of it somewhere around here. We might have to watch that one as a retro movie now, I'm actually thinking. Blade 2, Guillermo del Toro, is awesome, really awesome too. So maybe we can get into the Blade movies at some point here too, because that's what we like to do here on the channel. I'll talk about that towards the end of the show here too. Stephen Dorff, did he make a fool of himself? Did he put his foot in his mouth? What do you think about those comments about Marvel being worthless garbage? It just goes back into that theme of earlier this week. We were talking about comic book fatigue. It's on the edges of the culture, right? It's always going to be there. It's just going to be something that's lingering in the back of everybody's mind. I see what you were doing there, Stephen. I see what you were doing there, trying to promote your own movie. All right, Tobey Maguire is in the headlines again, talking about Spider-Man. And I guess some people are saying that it's good news because it's going to pave the way for a new Spider-Man with Tobey Maguire, which it won't. And I don't know why the page is frozen right now, but it is. So I can't... Tobey Maguire reflects on getting back into the Spider-Man suit with No Way Home. I guess there's some more quotes and stuff coming out that people are farming. As I said, it's been slow. It's been kind of a slow day. Now, No Way Home was my favorite movie of that year because of Tobey Maguire and Andrew Garfield coming back as Spider-Man. And seeing all three of them together was a true highlight. A true highlight. Let's see what he said here. The suit can definitely be a challenge at time when you've got to get into the full thing. But then once you're comfortable, there is something fun about it. As an actor, it helps when you get into your costume. You begin to feel it more and embody it more. You start to feel pretty at home pretty swiftly. Now that's just a comment. People are just saying that, oh, that's got to mean that he's got to be open for another Spider-Man reunion with Sam Raimi to make Spider-Man 4. No. That's not what I would read into that comment. But it was cool seeing all three of them together. I've said it before and I'll say it again. Andrew Garfield is my favorite Spider-Man. And I think Tom Holland is my favorite Peter Parker. Because they would... they tried to make Andrew Garfield's Spider-Man, or his Peter Parker, too young. They should have just made him the appropriate age. Like, he was already there kind of thing, right? That's the way I go. It's just cool to see all three of them together. It's just so awesome. So, yeah, some more behind-the-scenes stuff is coming out about that. I wouldn't read too much into it. Could he play Spider-Man again? Yes. I'm sure that they won't close the door on it. And it sounds... This is what I would take away from this. If they came up to him again and said, hey, we got a small little role in this Avengers Secret Wars. You want to be in it? And it sounds like his response would be, sure, why not? By the way that he's talking about it. Because some people talk about the suits and stuff like that and saying, oh, God, I really don't want to do that again kind of thing. Right? But not Tobey Maguire, it seems. Percy Jackson is in the news. Yesterday, this was trending on Twitter. Poseidon has been cast for the Percy Jackson series. And very interesting. Percy Jackson fans who wanted Logan Lerman as Poseidon. Yeah, because he played the original Percy Jackson, right, in the movies. They wanted him to come back in the TV series, but no. Somebody else is going to be playing him. One of the villains from one of the Bond movies. We'll show them down here. And Lance... not Lance Hendrickson, Lance Reddick, yeah, is going to be Zeus. That's cool. That's a cool casting. And Toby Stevens is going to be Poseidon. We just saw Lance Reddick in that Resident Evil series on Netflix that everybody hated, but I didn't mind it. And Toby Stevens, yeah, he was the villain in one of Pierce Brosnan's. Was it No Time to... no, not No Time to Die. I can't remember which one it was. The one where he fights with Madonna, right? He jokes... He fences with him, right? That one. Am I thinking of that right? Yeah. So that's up there, and people's got some reactions to it. If you listen closely, you can hear the person who tweets about it, Logan Lerman, as Poseidon every week, fall to their knees and scream. Yeah, so I guess there was some campaign out there from the fans to say, we really want this to happen. We really want this to happen. And it's kind of like, well, guys, this is not the way to go around about it. Is there going to be a boycott for this new series? Well, there already sort of was with the casting of the other characters. I don't know what fans think sometimes. I really don't. They're both competent actors. From what I've heard, this guy, Schobel, was his name, right? Who plays Percy in the series. He was in that Netflix movie with Ryan Reynolds, The Adam Project, and he was really good in that. So I'm holding out that this new Percy Jackson series is going to be cool. Lance Reddick is Zeus. Release the Kraken. I can't wait to hear him say that. Right? He's going to say that? He is, right? No? Yes? I don't think so. All right. Let's go into some hit or miss headlines. Talking about petitions to try to get things back. Hit or miss headlines is when, if it's a hit, we'll talk about it. If it's a miss, we'll move on. Canceled Netflix shows, fans now pleading for another streamer to revive it. Yes, Warrior Nun was canceled on Netflix. So fans of the series are out there on social medias trying to promote Apple TV Plus to pick up it and continue the series. Guys, as I said, this is not the way to go about things. It's harmless if you just tweet about it, right? But when you try to corral people to like sign all these petitions and get out there and plague people, which this campaign seems to be doing. Eva hugs everyone at Apple TV Plus, save Warrior Nun. Hey, you could have a great production and stuff like that. Okay, well, that's fairly not that friendly. But then it says retweet and reply with Apple TV. Saying revive our show. So it's a campaign to like flood their feeds with that. And that's kind of like where I draw the line. No, don't do that. Don't badger people at another company to go out and do this. Cause that's not the way. I think I even said, I saw somewhere on here that people said, contact information for executives at the company too. Right. And that's not the way to go. Like, posting this with the hashtag save Warrior Nun, that's harmless, right? Right? Like the restore the Snyderverse kind of tweet. It's when you actually go out there and you try to find people to try to make it happen. It's kind of like, that's across the line for me. That's kind of a hit headline. Warrior Nun, were you a fan of the series? Did you watch it? Could it get picked up somewhere else? Possibly, but I don't know if badgering people is the way to go about it. What else is next in the hit or miss? This is kind of cool. Giancarlo Esposito joins Francis Ford Coppola's passion project, Megalopolis. Yes, Megalopolis is that movie where Francis Ford Coppola is funding it himself, like $100 million of it himself. So that's cool. And we just saw Giancarlo Esposito in that Kaleidoscope series on Netflix. He's also, of course, in Better Call Saul and Breaking Bad and stuff like that. He's our Moff Gideon in the Mandalorian series. Great actor. Cool. Megalopolis. No release date on Megalopolis yet, because last we heard that there was some production issues, right? Some people were leaving the production, but not from the cast. The cast is good for it. Adam Driver, He's going to be in that 65 movie with the dinosaurs and stuff like that. So that one's cool. Forrest Whitaker is always cool. Natalie Emmanuel, John Voight, Lawrence Fishburne. Aubrey Plaza is going to be in this. Oh, cool. We just saw her in Emily the Criminal. Aubrey Plaza is one of my actresses that I'm keeping my eye on for sure. Great cast. Shia LaBeouf, Jason Schwartzman. Wow. Francis Ford Coppola is going to try to put up with Shia LaBeouf, huh? All I hear, like, Shia LaBeouf is a great actor, but apparently working with him is not an easy task to endure. It's not. D.B. Sweeney, Dustin Hoffman, James Remar, Chloe Fineman. Wow. Wow. Huge cast. Huge cast. And you're just adding more talent to it? Why not? Giancarlo Esposito, that's a hit in my book. That's definitely a hit. What's next? Harry Potter's Rupert Grint is more open to returning as Ron Weasley. Well, having trouble finding work be an issue? And I didn't mind him as Ron. So he's not retired, right? Like, there were talks that, you can't see her here, but Emma Watson, she was flirting with retirement, and she hasn't been in anything recently. I think she's going to start a family, actually, to tell you the truth. Because they're in their 30s now, right? And it wouldn't shock me that she would start a family. Anyway, I think if the timing was right and everyone was kind of coming back, I would definitely revisit it. It's a character that's important to me. I kind of grew up with him. Well, lots of people grew up with you guys. We kind of became the same person. I feel very protective of him as well. Yeah. So they could do something. And I'm sure that... was it the studio executive of in charge of it? Did this fall under Zaslav Bander? They want to make more. They want to make more Potter. And it sounds like the Fantastic Beasts series is pretty much dead in the water. It's done now, right? According to Eddie Redmayne. And the box office numbers for it have kind of declined. We'll have to see. I'm sure there's going to be pitches and stuff like that. It really depends on Radcliffe too, right? Because he's been branching out doing stuff that he likes to do and getting recognition for like that Weird Al Yankovic movie and stuff, right? So who knows? He'd be open for it, just like if they came a knocking. It sounds like he'd be up on board for that. Why not? Mark Glass Viking says, a lot of Netflix shows like Warrior Nun tend to wash over me. Once watched, soon forgotten, but entertaining nonetheless. Nonetheless. I see what you did there. Any more hit or miss headlines? Yep. One more. Okay. Every Star Wars movie that didn't happen. Yeah. Now, guys, now if you don't know, I don't try to tout it too much, but yeah, The Empire Strikes Back is my favorite movie of all time. I can watch it on repeat. I love the soundtrack. Sometimes I just put on the soundtrack and I can watch the entire movie in my head. I just love it so much. It's got all the elements in there for me. So, yeah, there's been a bunch of projects that were canceled. So I just pulled this to see what they were talking about. George Lucas's episode 7, 8, and 9. Yeah. When he sold it to Disney, he had like treatments for 7, 8, and 9. And then they looked at it and they were kind of like, well, just leave that on the door on your way out, George. And they just rewrote everything. They kept some elements. They try to say they kept some elements and say that that was George's plan for Luke to go off and be a recluse. No, it was his story for him to have a romantic partner, but not become a recluse. He was going to go off and try to find like the source of the Force. With the wills, which we never really got into again, right? With the wills. Because the original script for Star Wars 4 was like Journal of the Wills, right? So he was going to explore a lot more of that stuff. And it was going to be far out there, abstract ideas. I seen some of the concept art of it. And it was kind of like, that would have been cool to do that. Because, you know, Lucas would have made Star Wars movies that, just like the prequels, people would have been like, well, I don't know if I like them. But eventually, people are coming around to the prequels and saying, well, it's not that bad. It wasn't as bad as people were been touting. Because the prequels suffered from like that bandwagon hate of people, of the popular people saying, ooh, they're terrible, they're awful. And then people just got on board with that. I'm not a bandwagoner. I try not to be. That's what happened. Anyway, Colin Trevorrow's episode 9. Yeah, the Duel of the Fates movie that was supposed to come. I would have preferred to have seen that movie than The Rise of Skywalker. Yeah. But it, apparently it had involved a lot more of Princess Leia, and she passed on, so that could not have happened. Carrie Fisher, right? J.D. Dillard's Star Wars movie. Yeah, I heard about that too. The filmmaker of Slight, writer Matt Owens from Luke Cage. Yeah, I didn't even know about that one until recently, and then apparently that one got scrapped. Standalone Boba Fett movie with Josh Trank. That'll go down in infamy, right? And that movie sort of got transformed into what Book of Boba Fett was, which would have been good as a movie, and it didn't really work as a series, I would say. Yeah. Yeah. I hope they make another one. I do hope they still work with Boba Fett. Well, Temuera Morrison is still with us and still wants to play the role. And I hope they make him... Don't make him like the soft kind of guy that he's become. Make him the hard-edged crime boss. That's what we want to see, right? All right, let's move on. Obi-Wan Kenobi trilogy. Was that supposed to be a trilogy? Yeah, Billy Elliot director Stephen Daltrey was supposed to do that one. Fascinating. Okay, Obi-Wan Kenobi trilogy. One of the film's writers, Stuart Beatty from Collateral. Oh, from Collateral. Revealed the plan for an Obi-Wan trilogy. That would have been cool to see. But you know what? They can still continue with that on. If they were to find that, I want to see more Obi-Wan series. Have him come back and fight or close off the storyline with Darth Maul. Do that. Have that Zack Snyder pitched a Star Wars movie? Fascinating. But this was apparently even before the sale. This was before the sale to Disney that Zack Snyder had this, right? His own Star Wars film, inspired by Akira Kurosawa and The Seven Samurai. That one would have been cool. Zack Snyder taking on Star Wars. I would have been on board for that, for sure. Splinter of the Mind's Eye. Based on the book? Kyber Crystal. Yeah. Solo 2. Yeah, Solo 2 isn't happening. I'm sorry. Yeah, the guys from the Game of Thrones, David Benioff and D.B. Weiss trilogy, supposed to be like the Old Republic kind of stuff, right? But that never happened. And I don't know why that didn't happen. They said creative issues or creative differences, right? At least that one got squashed before we actually started to shoot it. Oh, yeah. It is what it is. Stop saying that. You gotta watch yourself. Okay, that's pretty much all I got in the can. Let's take a look at what's opening up this weekend, guys. As I said, I'm going out to see Infinity Pool today at 4 p.m. So look forward to my straight out of the theater reaction for that. But what can you see at the theaters this weekend? Opening up this weekend is only going to be Infinity Pool. But, of course, you can see Avatar The Way of Water in its regular form or its high frame rate or 3D or Ultra AVX. Puss in Boots is still playing. Infinity Pool right there. See preview. Let's take a look at this. See how many people are in the theater. Only 5. But people will learn about it. And that's the 4 o'clock show. Is it a 7 o'clock show? Got some more people in there? Not really. But I'll be looking forward to that. Brandon Cronenberg directs Alexander Skarsgård and Mia Goth in that. So I'll be looking forward to that. Over at the Landmark, they've got Banshees of Inisherin. I'm guessing because of the Oscar nominations this week, they're going to try to reintroduce these back into the theater so people can go see them. Hopefully, they put in Triangle of Sadness so I can go see that. Wandering, Left Behind. Pathan is out in theaters as well. Missing is worth seeing. Man Called Otto, meh. Plane, yes. Megan, meh. Whitney Houston, never saw it. Puss in Boots, yeah. Avatar The Way of Water, yeah. Elvis is coming back today for only one show. And Everything Everywhere All at Once is going to be in the theater too. Both thumbs up there. That's kind of cool. Anything else playing at this different landmark? Yeah, they're playing the Infinity Pool there too as well. Gandhi Godsi Ik Yud, Hindi movie. Okay. Pathan. Pathan is the big action one that everybody will be watching, right? Maybe I should go take that in, as long as the weather outside permits. The Sun, Man Called Otto, Plane, Some Boots, The Whale. Oh, yeah, yeah. There you go, because of Oscar considerations, right? Oh, and The Fablemans is still playing here. Huh, fascinating. So that's what's opening up this weekend, guys. Are you going to go check out any of those films? Are you gonna go, can you go out and check out some of those films in your markets? Because sometimes, you know, in international markets, things just haven't opened up just yet. All right. If you know, if a trailer drops, I'll do a trailer reaction for it as quickly as I can, guys. If a new news, big story comes out, it'll come out as a short. Let me just take a quick look here at the old Twitter or Reddit roundup part. See what's going on here. John Wick is going to be on Total Film cover. Cool. Andrea Riseborough is... The Academy is reportedly looking at whether or not Andrea Riseborough's grassroots campaign violated campaign rules. Because she was nominated for Best Actor, right? The issue will also likely be raised at the Board of Governors meeting this Tuesday. So she might get removed from actress? Because of campaign violations? Huh. Arglass says if they adapted the Timothy Zahn Star Wars books, that would be incredible. I would love that too. Because that had Mara Jade in it. It had, obviously, Thrawn. Colleen Hoover. Yeah, we talked about that story with Blake Lively. That's good pictures. I like the red. Yeah, Blake Lively's cool. Let's give that the old heart. Blake Lively. More Blake Lively. Alexander Skarsgård. The cast, Robert Eggers, Nosferatu, includes Lily Rose Depp, Bill Skarsgård, Nicholas Holt, and Willem Dafoe. Yeah, we'll talk about that a little bit more tomorrow on the Horror Weekly Roundup that Willem Dafoe has joined that cast for that. Okay, there's that girl joining that Thunderbolts movie. Willem Dafoe. Okay. Yeah. All right. Pedro Pascal is going to debut hosting the SNL. Okay. So they're getting some good cast people there because Aubrey Plaza just did it for them, right? The Recruit starring Noah Centineo has been renewed for a second season on Netflix. Is that a series that we should be watching? The Recruit. Hmm. What's that on the tomato meter? Let's take a look. Now, it's probably going to give me the older version. Because there was a movie called The Recruit, right? No? Yes? 67% by the critics, 86% by the audience. So people are liking it a lot more. And I think it's only like 6 episodes or something, isn't it? Yeah, I just started watching Narcos. Pedro Pascal is great in it. Okay, cool. The Recruit, renewed for a second season. Laura Haddock. Anybody else I recognize? Not really. The Recruit is a great show. So we might have to check that out, because we do have a slot open here. Let me talk about that, because it's going to be coming up next week. I've kind of been filling in the schedule for next week, because I'm going to post it every Sundays now, guys, on the community tab on YouTube. We'll be posting the upcoming week's schedules, because everybody's going to be voting in polls. As I said, on Thursdays we do retro movies. So I put up the poll yesterday. And Arnie's just winning out slowly on that one, right? For Total Recall, the 1990 Total Recall over Candyman. Now, I wanted to watch Candyman with you guys, the 1992 version. So we'll have to fit that in somewhere. I wanted to watch it with you guys because when we watch the 2021 version, because this Saturday, Soho won out. 76%. It was Candyman. 2021 wasn't going to catch up, but I wanted to go back and watch the original Candyman with you guys because this one has some Easter eggs in here that will be very poignant. Will be very. You need to, if you know the events of what happened in the original Candyman, it pays off in the sort of reboot of this version. It's really cool how it's tied in. What do they call it? A requel? A requel? Yeah, so Candyman 2021, written by Jordan Peele, is like a requel to the this one. So there's we'll have to figure it in somehow in our schedule. Because, as I said, the schedule that I've been posting up on the community tab for next week is starting to fill out. And I'll just let you know a little bit of what it's going to look like now. Mondays is going to be the same. Movie news and then The Last of Us in the afternoon. Tuesday, we're going to be watching All Quiet on the Western Front. Starting at 9:30 a.m. on Tuesday, we'll be watching All Quiet on the Western Front. Franchise movie day, we're going to be starting the Scream series 10 a.m. on Wednesday. So next week we'll start with Scream 1, and then the week after that will be Scream 2, 3, 4, and 5, all the way up until Scream 6 when that comes out in March. Yeah, so that'll be our Wednesdays. It'll be Scream Wednesdays. And then as you can see, Thursdays there will be the retro movies that you guys will be voting on. And right now, Arnold is in the lead for that. Next week. And then, of course, as you can see, Fridays, as we've done here, I was going to slate it for 10 a.m., but as I said, there wasn't that much in there. So I may just keep it at 11 a.m., and then I got an open movie slot here. So that's why in an hour from now, we're going to be watching You People on Netflix. Watch along right now in just over an hour. Jonah Hill. Eddie Murphy, hopefully it's a fun movie. And then I'm going to jump out and I'm going to go see Infinity Pool in the theater. So busy day for me. And then on Saturdays we do the Horror Weekly and then our horror movie that you guys pick on the community tabs. And as I said, for next week, I'll post up the choices for that on after we watch our movie on Saturday. And I'm probably going to rework back in the Candyman if Candyman loses out. Yeah. Nobody, no interest for old. That's okay. I don't need to revisit that one. But that's coming up. So pay attention a lot more to the community tab there on the channel because you guys will get updates and the ability to interact and stuff like that. I think one of those polls, once we get some more traction, the polls will become a members-only feature. Which means you'll have to subscribe to the channel and then you'll be able to vote for stuff. But because members will know what kind of qualities I'm looking for. Like, does it have a lot of nudity? If it's got graphic nudity, we can't watch it right here on the channel, right? So yeah, we'll be looking forward to that. And if you like movies, everything movies here, guys, everything. So hit that thumbs up button, subscribe, and I'll see you on Monday for more movie news. If not, I'll see us for... another movie watch along this afternoon. Enjoy your weekend, and I'll see you next time on Mirror Domains.